We are pleased to present the International Hydro Diplomacy, Building and Strengthening Regional Institutions for Water Conflict Prevention, pre-conference study commissioned and led by the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung with support from the Stimson Center. Himalayan Water Governance, Reimagining Institutions, Science, and Transboundary Cooperation by Nilanjan Ghosh and Deepak Gyawali. Key issues at stake. Water conflicts across the Himalayan river basins in South Asia are ubiquitous, occur at various scales, and are of various types. The large-scale failures of the Track 1 approaches reveal that governing the Himalayan river basins should ideally be based on a consensual approach involving all riparian stakeholders. These must then be calibrated against national interests to search for out-of-the-box solutions and trade-offs, and then persuade the other side to put them on Track 1 agenda. This process needs to be implemented through transboundary interactions using multiple legitimate sublayers that include technical and social science academia, activist groups, businesses, and also interests of federal states or actors at subnational levels, all the while keeping Track 1 players engaged and informed without requiring them to take public positions. This approach would enable open discussions that otherwise will lurk beneath the surface and stymie official discussions. Therefore, water negotiations eventually emerge as a two-level, three-style game. At the international transboundary level, at subnational federal levels, and between actors of state, market, and civic movements where sectoral issues of economics, law, ecology, social justice, and many others play out. Contrary to global best practices, South Asia's collaboration on transboundary waters has been bilateral and issue-based, thereby eluding nexus basin-level approaches to resolutions and governance. Bilateral treaties signed between countries revealed mixed results. For an overview of bilateral water treaties in the region, see Table 2. The Indus Water Treaty signed in 1960 between India and Pakistan has been hailed as a success story that has survived wars between the two nations. The treaty is construed as a response to the partition of British-ruled India into India and Pakistan in 1947, which converted the Indus into an international transboundary river basin. Brokered by the World Bank, the treaty rendered control of the three eastern rivers of the basin, namely the Bias, Ravi, and Sutlej to India, and those of the three western rivers, namely the Indus, Chenab, and Jhelum to Pakistan. However, recent geopolitical tensions between the two nations have often resulted in statements of misgivings, even though weaponizing water seems to be improbable, given the fact that any form of upstream intervention will be socio-ecologically unsustainable at the basin scale. The Bangladesh-India water conflict about the Ganges emerged over water sharing during dry season at the point of the Faraka Barrage, constructed in West Bengal in 1975 to divert water through the Hooghly distributary to resuscitate the excessively silting port in Kolkata, an eastern Indian metropolis. While a 1996 Ganges water sharing treaty apparently resolved the issue, the stream flow depletion in the main course of the Ganges and eventually the distributaries still loom large. The Sundarbans archipelago, which is part of the Ganges-Brahmaputra-Meghna Delta, has seen land losses due to sea level rise, salinity ingress due to lack of freshwater flow, and a lack of soil resuscitation due to decline in sediment flow, with sediments getting trapped in the upstream of the Faraka Barrage. The lack of freshwater has affected fisheries substantially in the mainstream in Bangladesh and India. One interesting example is the hindering of Hilsa catch with large-sized catch in the range of 2.5 to 3 kgs being almost extinct. This has also seriously affected agriculture in the Sundarbans Delta, where usually freshwater is converting large tracts of agricultural land into brackish aquaculture ponds. With the 30-year duration GWS treaty coming to an end in 2026, the utility of the barrage is still being questioned. Within India, Bihar, one of India's eastern states, has claimed that upstream floods are caused due to backwater flows resulting from sediment deposition upstream of the barrage. On the positive side, it is claimed that the non-tidal West Bengal has become water secured due to the water diversion through the Hooghly Channel because of the Faraka barrage. On the other hand, the unresolved Teesta water controversy over dry season water sharing between India and Bangladesh has been brewing and turned into a complicated two-level game, with the state of West Bengal claiming that there is no adequate water to be shared with downstream Bangladesh. In a similar vein, India's Kosi and Gandak treaties with Nepal have been the basis of political rancor in Nepal and India's Bihar due to unmet expectations of future economic developments. The Kosi and Gandak barrages, built on the Nepal-India border, are managed by the Indian Bihar government. The Kosi barrage was envisaged as a stopgap measure until the construction of the Kosi High Dam for flood control, irrigation and hydropower generation. Failure to move the Kosi High Dam project forward all these decades has fed a political discourse in Nepal of being cheated and in Bihar of Nepal sending floods. The 1996 Mahakali Treaty, another Nepal-India water agreement, is in limbo for the last 24 years. Even items such as the preparation of a detailed project report of the Pancheshwar High Dam, envisaged within 6 months upon signing the treaty, is yet to be completed and delivered. The matter has caused new tensions and current political battles over the Kalapani border dispute and the issuing of different maps about the headwaters of Mahakali. It has further complicated official engagement mechanisms with high-level official meetings, originally designed to take place every 6 months, not taking place for years. Moreover, India's post-independence embankment building spree, which has left large tracts of fertile land waterlogged in Bihar and eastern Uttar Pradesh in India, is now having impact on Nepal's southern Terai region, giving rise to much rancor. India's river linking project has been met with opposition from environmental activists within India as well as bilateral riparians. Groundwater mismanagement within countries, of springs in the hills and of contiguous aquifers in the plains, is rampant and threatens water security of exploding urban settlements as well as agriculture that has contributed to the Green Revolution. Finally, the China-India issues over the Brahmaputra have largely been a matter of misreporting and misinformation regarding the basics of basin hydrometeorology with China's upstream construction plans, especially hydropower in Yarlung Tsangpo, being of particular concern for many Indian strategic thinkers who feel that Chinese water diversion plans will dry up the Brahmaputra in India. Also, the high monsoon data sharing agreement between China and India over the Brahmaputra is flawed due to wrong choice of measuring stations in Tibet, located in rain shadow areas and therefore less likely to provide any realistic early warning for flooding or extreme events. At CUZ MDPD, we design and implement multi-stakeholder dialogues, focusing on the nexus of democracy and governance, peace and security, and climate and energy. Join our LinkedIn community, tag us in your tweets, and add us on Facebook. Thank you for tuning in to us on SoundCloud, Spotify, and YouTube. Visit our website for our latest publications.